welcome everyone to this time of worship, during which we will worship our Almighty God. He is good and His love endures forever. I'm Pastor Sweis. I serve here at Emmanuel Church in Middleton, the heart of the valley. And these services are being watched at different seniors' homes. And we just love that you're able to be part of this and that you too will raise your voices and your thoughts in worship of our Almighty God. I've got Bob Boutilier here beside me who will be playing the piano for us. And we invite you to just sing along if you're able and at least to focus on the words that we will be singing and speaking. And in that, give praise to this incredible God. I'd like to begin by reading from Psalm 104. Praise the Lord, my soul. Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. The Lord wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out the heavens like a tent and lays the beams of his upper chambers on the water. He makes the clouds his chariot and rides in the wings of the wind. He makes winds his messengers, flames of fire his servants. He is our Almighty God. And so let's worship him. Father, would you enable us now to just focus on you, to give you all the praise that you are worthy of. Father, I pray for any of those who are part of this service now, that if there is anything that's hindering them from worshiping you, Lord, that you would take that away, that you would enable them, strengthen them to overcome and to give you the praise that is due to your holy name. So, Father, we thank you for this time. And we trust that it will be of encouragement to us, your people, but ultimately, and even more importantly, may it be of worship to you, our King. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're going to be singing a few songs today. And the first one is going to be "To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Has Done."
Life on earth.
Singing is I Need Thee Every Hour, and oh, how true that is, how we need Him every hour. My soul. He hideth my soul.
My Lord, the one.
Let us pray. Father, what an incredible privilege it is to know that we can be covered by your love, Lord, through forgiveness, through the faith that you've granted to us in Jesus Christ, your Son. Lord, this is nothing that we've done on our own. This is certainly not something, this privilege that we deserve. It's something that you've graciously poured out on us when we placed our trust in what Jesus did on the cross and the resurrection. We thank you. We praise you. We humbly now come before you in prayer, continuing our worship. Lord, you are worthy. You are good. You are love. And in these troubled times, we gladly draw near to you and hide in the cleft of the rock. Lord, you are good. And Father, it is my prayer now that all those who are watching this and worshiping along with this video would be able to experience your favor and experience your presence in our lives. Lord, may this be so much more than just singing some Christian songs and listening to somebody deliver a short sermon. Father, may this truly be us drawing near to you and praising you. For again, Lord, you are worthy. Father, for those who are struggling with health and loneliness, maybe depression, Father, those who are struggling with pain and grief, Lord, I pray especially for them that those struggles would not get in their way of honoring you, of experiencing your goodness, but Lord, that those struggles would instead draw us ever near to yourself. Lord, we look to you to be our rock on which we build our lives. Lord, we look to you to have your way with us. Lord, as we now open your word and look at how our prayer life might even be transformed by your power, Lord, I pray you would have your way with us and that we would indeed learn to pray different and draw near to you in a different way, maybe. Lord, altogether, that you may have your way in our lives, for you are Lord, you are our master. God, have your way with us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, at Emmanuel Church, we've been working our way through a series of messages that are all about the Holy Spirit working in us and through us and really changing us bit by bit. And when we think of that, we often think about our character traits, right? How the Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. How the Spirit changes that. But we've been taking a slightly different angle at this whole theme at Emmanuel Church this summer. And one of the ways that we see the Holy Spirit change people is in the way they pray. And I would just like for you to consider that for a moment. See, as a pastor, I sit in on many prayers, as you can well imagine. As I meet with people, I will often pray with them. But a lot of times, people will join in that prayer, and or there'll be prayer meetings, and a lot of the prayers that I hear being prayed kind of go along this outline. It begins with thanking God, and of course, that's a good thing, right? And then we present God with our requests. And so we thank God. Thank you, Lord, for this good day. Thank you, Lord, for life. Thank you, Lord, for beautiful weather. We know we should start our prayers off with some praise, right? It's the right thing because God is good and his love endures forever. So we should praise him, and we certainly should be in the habit of spending time thanking God. But then we switch over to the second part of our prayers, where we often present God with a bit of our wish list. We really value comfort in life, and so if there's something that's hindering our comfort, we will ask God to take that away. So if there's pain, Lord, please take the pain away. Or if it's uncertainty, Lord, Take the uncertainty away, or grant us certainty, or whatever that looks like, whatever makes us comfortable, is often what people will pray for. Now, I get that, and God wants to hear our prayers, and so by all means. However, with one of the small groups I'm involved with, we've been reading through the book of Acts. And when I look at the apostles and the believers in the early church, I'm telling you, they pray transformed prayers. They pray in a way that we often don't. And so I'd like to just read one of those stories to you about transformed prayer. And the passage I'm going to read to you from is found in Acts chapter 4. And Peter and John are hauled in front of the magistrates because they healed somebody and they're teaching in Jesus' name. And the magistrates, the religious leaders, of course, thought they were done with Jesus. They had killed him and they had him crucified and buried. But now there were these rumors about him having come back to life. And anyway, we know that Jesus ascended into heaven, but his followers continued to teach in the name of Jesus. They continued to do ministry in the name of Jesus. And this is what happened in the temple courts. And so Peter and John, they're in trouble with the religious leaders and they're hauled in front of their court. And then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, then know this. You and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved." I mean, there's the message of the good news of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the way. Before we even continue on this whole transformed prayer, please know this, that Jesus is the way. If you want to be rescued by God, if you want to be forgiven your sin, you'll need to place your trust in Jesus, what he did for you on the cross, when he died with the sins of this world on his shoulders, when he rose from the dead, defeating the penalty of sin, which is death. Place your trust in him. Confess your sin to him. Repent, as scripture says. And be saved. Now, of course, Peter and John are in front of the courts, right? They were in trouble with the law because, well, they were still talking in the name of Jesus. So the religious leaders, while they conferred and what are we going to do with these guys? Well, they didn't really know what to do, but so they send them on the way with some threats of violence. After further threats, they let them go. They could not decide how to punish them because all the people were praising God for what had happened, for the man who was miraculously healed was over 40 years old. Now, we're talking about prayer, right? So now imagine you being Peter or John. You had just been threatened with violence if you were to speak in the name of Jesus. And now you're being let go this time with this warning, and now you're going to go gather with the other believers, and you're going to have a prayer meeting. What would your prayers sound like? My hunch that a lot of people today would say, "Thank you, God, for this good day, and thank you that we were let go with a warning today. And please, God, change those religious leaders and keep us safe." That's, I think, how a lot of people would pray today. But that is not how these people prayed. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. "Sovereign Lord," they said, "you made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them." Oh, they were praising God, all right. They praised God for who he was, the Creator God. And we'll skip down to verse 29. "Now, Lord, consider their threats." Consider their threats. "And enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness." They're not asking for safety. They're asking for God to enable them to speak the good news of Jesus with great boldness, which would get them in even more trouble with the religious leaders. They weren't going to stop speaking in the name of Jesus at all. They wanted to speak with even greater boldness, even though that would cause them much trouble with the religious leaders. That's exactly what happened. In the very next chapter, we see this take place. Again, they're hauled in front of the courts. And again, the people didn't really know how to deal with these people who were speaking in Jesus' name. But Gamaliel, one of the religious leaders, well, he had a speech, and his speech persuaded the rest of that court. And they called the apostles in and had them flogged. With no longer threats of violence, they were now being beaten severely. And they ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. And then the apostles left the Sanhedrin rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. Day after day in the temple courts and from house to house, they never stopped teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Messiah. See, these early believers, they were not praying for their comforts. They were not asking God to keep them comfortable at all. The early believers, what they did was pursue the will of God wholeheartedly, no matter the cost. They so had their eyes fixed on Jesus that their circumstances really no longer mattered to them. And it affected the way they prayed. They just prayed that God would have his way. God give us great boldness that we may speak that good news well. I'm challenged by that, my friends. So often that is not how we pray, is it? I think it's time for us to really be maybe a bit more careful in how we pray. To really give it some thought. To be intentional about what we say in prayer. What we thank God for. Not just the nice weather. I mean, what if the weather is not nice? Is God still not worthy of our thanksgiving? Of course he is. So we praise God for who he is. And then we pray that God would have his way with us. Less concerned about their circumstances, more concerned primarily with his will for our lives. More concerned with kingdom purposes. And then, yes, by all means, we can pray for healing. And we can pray for peace. And we can pray for all those things that we so deeply value. But let's be more intentional about how we pray and how we praise. Father, I ask you for your help in this. That we would not be so quick to just ask you to fix whatever we think is wrong in our lives. But Lord, to be more concerned with your will and with your kingdom purposes, and to be willing to even suffer for that, as we see the early church being willing to suffer. Father, help us with this. Holy Spirit, transform the way we pray. Transform the way we praise you. You are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're going to be singing one more song, and I've said it many times before. This is my personal favorite. It is well with my soul. And of course, it is well with our soul regardless of our circumstances, isn't it? I've often told you the story about my good friend Bill Ward, who, well, he was an older gentleman, very sick. As he laid on his couch, and I would come in and ask him, how are you doing today? He would say, almost shot. His body was broken down. But man, he was ready to go. It was well with his soul, for sure. May the same be true for us today. It is well.
What?
we thank you that all is well with our soul. Through faith in Jesus Christ, by your grace, God, you are worthy of our praise now and forevermore. So again, Lord, I pray that we would have that confidence we just sang of, that all is well with our soul, and that understanding, that feeling, that reality is not dependent on our temporary circumstances, our comforts, but Lord, that our true comfort is found in that relationship with you. So we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Now I'd like to leave you with this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. Amen.